Well, George, as always, Mike knows everything about these old bikes. And I'm sure we'll see you at the Venture Shop, Mike. Trouble free. Have a great ride. I don't want to tempt fate by saying that, but good luck. Have a nice ride. Thank you. So, push start lock. We haven't got clutches and gears like we've got on the modern machines. It's been a little bit shy. I think I need to get the lights off running with it. They are a little bit temperamental, so it's got a bit of vaporisation, carburation, stop lock, you know. The more modern engines have got, they're very susceptible to heat. This is Graham Hallard, we're just passed off at the bottom of the trail. So, here's Graham Hallard. Graham is one of HM7, Graham is a Wolverine Brenner. An overhead valve sports machine called the Footport, so called because it has very large inlet and exhaust ports for high performance. So it's difficult sporting man's choice of mount, sporting machine, flat pipe tank, personal authority, and I'd certainly drive that any day of the week. So lovely machine, Graham, have a nice time.
You know that's disappearing now anyway, don't you?
No. And this is Graham's wife, Brenda Hallard from the fire. Brenda's currently riding a 1913 AJS. It's a first of the first field. Among the things, it's quite advanced. It hasn't got a gear change. It's got a turn and clutch. And a turn and clutch in 1913 is quite an unusual feature. Most constantly engaged with the engine and you're at a full of fixed ratio.
And even standing around,
the equipment chain drive, whereas most bikes of the field were equipment belt. So it's a very advanced machine. So again, Brenda is a very stalwart rider. She rides these machines, you know, very expertly. So have a great ride, Brenda, and have a nice day. Thank you. Number 8, and number 11, a very, very little shot. Made a ship in Yorkshire. They are a two-stroke machine, which you recognise by the plumes that are flowing out of the back of the silencers. It's sort of a Scott trademark, really. But Scott were the pioneers of two-stroke, which became very, very popular with the Japanese, and they kept capable of a very, very high performance. Scots were multiple TT winners, and basically, if you won the TT, that put you on the map as a sporting motorcycle manufacturer. So there was a great rivalry for manufacturers to try and get a machine which was capable of winning the Isle of Man TT race, and Scots were indeed successful. Cynically, if the bike managed to start in the first place, it would probably win the TT. So they are temperamental, but they are beautiful when they're running. So have a great ride, Neil. Lovely, thank you. Real dispatch, good for you. Number 11. This is John Smith and family. John's riding a fantastic AJS, it's the H1, the 800cc, the combination. The WK registration is Coventry. WK with the Coventry registration license, it is in actual fact. So registered in Coventry, very original machine, equipment is original sidecar. And that was the choice of, you know, a rich family could afford this as family transport. And again, in 1927, you really were king of the road on a big AJS big twin. So you really enjoy being king of the road, John. John's a good one. Thank you very much. Thank you for that. And you could ride that thing for miles. That's going to shatter the performance, but it will just keep going. So, enjoy your ride, Dave. Great job. Thank you. Number 74. This is a Triumph Junior. Triumph, a proper Triumph, which was made at the Irish Speedworks, where the effectively cost the university is now. That was the original Priory Street work. And if you're asking yourself about Triumph, say, well, name the famous British motorcycle, you probably say, well, it's Triumph through and through. Well, started by two Germans, Siegfried Bettmann and Moritz Schultz. Bettmann was the Lord Mayor of Coventry when the First World War broke out. And they started the Triumph company, which was positioned at Priory Street in Coventry, to run all the way down from where the Herbert Art Gallery is, all the way down to the bus station. And that was obviously destroyed in November 1940 in the Blitz, and they subsequently moved production to America. This is a proper Triumph made in Coventry. It's the 225 Junior model, equipped with a original petrol can accessory on the back. And I'll say that's getting limited fuel capacity in these machines, so as you can see, we've got a little bit of spare on the back just for contingency. And that beautiful round petrol tank, lovely, beautiful. So, go have a nice ride. I hope it restarts for you. Thank you very much. That's David Payne. Just paddle off. There we go, jump through. Now, look at the handlebars. This is a lovely overhead cam bumper. I mean, what a fantastic machine. And this is Frank Chapman from Bryce Norton. It's Frank's first CNCC outing on this bumper. It's a recent restoration, and you know, what a machine. It's got those little wide handlebars. There was a famous man who introduced the vintage called George Dance, and I reckon you're looking like George Dance on that today. And Frank's got lots of thoroughbred machines in his collection, and I think you can drop it straight round in my garage, Frank. I'll look after it for you. Have a nice ride. Cheers. First time out on the event, that's a beautiful job. And again, we've got a Chevrolet GF. They are flying the flag high. This is very nice. It's a K7, 352C. Short chain drive. You see the little valve popping up and down on the top there, overhead valve. Straight away, that's it for us. That's a sporting machine. Nice big front brake. Maybe not upgraded slightly from the original, but very nice too. Very lightweight. Big engine really for the size of the machine. And that's the Chevy one. I think you'll see a good 75 mile an hour on that all day long. Have a nice ride. Look at the machine. It's got an overhead valve bar. Very nice. Look at the steering wheel. This is a matchless, so we've got something a little bit different. Look at the steering body. And, oh, just smell the air there.